also, Paul, I don't know if Max has talked about this, but just about everything, you can play 1 nanosecond early, just so that the sound generally comes from the bass through the cellos, violas, and also the stronger you are, the easier it is for us to be sweet, if you know what I mean, in comparison to Il Bruto. Okay, let's just play the very end, so about 120. And again, and down.
I've been friends with Derek for many, many years, Derek Hynd, who's one of the most brilliant surfers on the planet and certainly one of the most creative. So for quite a few years, we've been urged to collaborate and come up with something.
And eventually this idea of Musica Surfica, just getting the two forces, you know, the so-called high art or fine arts, and seeing how they collide with surfing.
Stays, sheep on hillside, bird on bough, pause and listen in amaze. Cair and air and air and air.
So Derek's approach was to invite surfers from different walks of life to come and surf King Island without fins.
Was it a dream? Were all asleep or did she cease her strain? For the seals with a splash dive into the deep and the world goes on again.
What we've tried to get towards in this event is combining the ancient Hawaiian style of riding wooden boards without any finned devices, and the potential of new boards, which are just working on bottom contours. And it really feels like relearning to surf, giving yourself a whole new perspective on the art of surfing. And it is an art form.
We wanted to open up the field musically and in surfing and see what we came up with. And of course, when you do that with Mr. Hynd, you end up with rather radical approaches to surfing.
I think my passion is investigating the unknown. To be able to deconstruct a situation and see how it unfolds has to be a key to life, doesn't it? Which is why we're on King Island right now. King Island represents one of the more isolated regions on the surfing planet. It's a dreamy island. Population growth isn't that dramatic. People who come here are always flabbergasted at how amazing the feeling is. There are only a few places in the world like this.
Hey,
how does it sound?
Sounds fun.
Yeah. Sort of just, I was just haunted.
Yeah, great.
Okay, then going on.
We brought Danny Spooner, Mike Kerrin, and other members of the ACO to King Island to be part of the inaugural Musica Surfica project, but also to develop an upcoming program for a national tour.
The wandering ploughman halts his plough, and the maid her milking stays. And sheep on hillside, bird on bough, pause and listen in amaze.
Confident that the surfers that arrive this week are going to find situations that they could never have expected 1 week ago.
Keeps the back as the back, and the front is the front. The nose is going forward, whereas without fins, you just spin. And so, and that's quite a liberating thing, because all of a sudden you find yourself surfing backwards. At first you just freak out, and your body positioning goes all over the shop, but then you realize that you can find a way of doing it, and you enjoy surfing backwards and then surfing sideways and surfing forward. So it creates the ultimate 360 degree surfing experience.
You feel as though you're with the wave, more like your body surfing. Surfing with fins is like skateboarding, because you're always turning off the back fins, where this is more like body surfing, because you're just all over the shop.
And everyone's got different approaches, but it really is a conversation with the unknown out there.
Snap of King Island on the head.
So tell us what happened.
That's what happened.
It's so fast. There's no friction to it. Just kapoo.
You don't have a choice of where you fall with these things. And so I just dived into the sand and I saw it. Got a chiropractic workout on my neck.
About Derek is that he's pushing himself in a way that you couldn't possibly imagine for a 50-year-old. He's a man of great grandeur, not so much in the clothes he wears or the food he eats, but in the way he inspires. And you could say, to quote somebody, it is art that makes grand our own stupid lives.
To describe our music, using the term classical music, I don't think really does it justice. Of course, we play music from the so-called classical tradition. We do so many different things. When we're on an international tour, the surfing analogy would be that we're surfing a 3 to 4 foot, very well-formed beach break, and we have to do certain maneuvers within that paradigm to fit the programming structure of the entrepreneurs that have booked us. What this whole fin-free thing has done is changed the paradigm, opened up the gates. I look at myself as a programmer in the same way, I suppose you could say, that a curator in an art museum, you know, putting improbable elements together can create a great chemistry on walls in an art gallery. The whole fin-free thing has allowed us to go open plan with the programming and put these improbable elements together.
This week was discipline for any surfer who knows what it's like to ride with fins.
You know, it's hard to even sort of express it as failing. I just, it's a part of a process of understanding and learning. And it's really, you know, how you move your body on your surfboard, how you react with the magic carpet between you and the water, and how you move with that. It's a real dance with nature, you know, the power force that's just uncontrollable. You cannot control a wave, you can't control the ocean, so you've got to move with her, and it's a dance with that element. So it's extremely difficult to get in tune with at times.
It's fantastic to see people who are, you know, absolutely at the top of their surfing field, you know, getting out there without fins and friction-free falling down a wave and failing on the takeoff and then getting up and realizing that it's about weight placement and that it can be done, and then trying again and again, and then eventually throwing a 360, and the hoots and exultation that comes with it is exhilarating. And that is fundamentally what this is all about opening up kids' minds. You know, rather than just training kids, you know, to do their slash and burn surfing, and they listen to exactly the same music, eat exactly the same food, the celebration of the individual. And that's what this friction-free thing is about as well.
So you want me on the bottom?
Yeah, I reckon. Yeah, so I reckon that's cool. Yeah, yeah, that's good. And but I reckon. That's great.
Yeah. Australia is a very programmed land, whereas Australia grew being anything but. And even if there's a little shard poking out in the wilderness saying, don't just walk down the standard line, then I think it's more in Australia's makeup than just about any other country on earth.
I think it's a great way to look at other expressions that we can have in the ocean rather than just, you know, surf, turns, airs, nose rides, whatever else. So, you know, little spins and just how difficult it can be to hold a line. And I think it's been a fantastic thing to see Tom's Alayas, how hard it was for the people way back when they used to ride that same equipment, and how amazing it is that they stuck with it long enough to be able to actually ride a wave on those boards.
See this curve here? This roll right here is what's going to hold the board into the wave as you're going across the wave. This roll sucks the board into the wave just enough to keep it going across a real steep face. If you had less roll, it might slide sideways. If you have more roll, you'd be going across and the board would suck too much and you just end up out the back of the wave. It actually stops, it's like a parachute of too much roll. So really getting this curve right here is just everything.
The design of this board, it's a Kikoho design, ancient Hawaiian surfboard. It was inspired by a board my dad brought home from Hawaii, which he made with Tom Parker Stone over there. And yeah, it's just got the rolled bottom and the round rails, and it's a bit thicker than the Alayas, and it's got the round rails where the Alaya has the thinner square-edged rail.
For us also, part of this Musica Surfica thing was the acknowledgement of history and the role it plays in the amazing gift that we have to be surfers. And so dealing with someone like Tom Wagener, who is, you know, like a luthier, a violin maker. He's dealing in the history, the original history of the Hawaiian kings and what they did on their surf craft. And the lineage is there.
Before the ancient Hawaiians went surfing, they got their boards down to the beach and they put kukui nut oil all over them. And then they went surfing. And also in ancient Hawaiian lore, the surfboard was one of the most important things a person owned. In the early sketches, you have the king standing there, and he's got a surfboard in front of him, you know. His wife's over there someplace, and the house is over there, but man, his surfboard is front and center, which really goes to show how what they thought of him.
And on to Wegener. He is blazing a trail from 16 feet without a fin down to a 3-foot plank of wood, and with a smile on his face all the way through. And not compromising the desire to step back in time to experience what his forebears were experiencing.
Well, surfing's probably the oldest continuous sport in the entire world, because the Polynesians have been, there's surfing all over the South Pacific, from New Zealand to Tahiti to Hawaii. So even before they went to Hawaii, they were probably surfing, because they only went to Hawaii 1,200 years ago. But there's probably a surfing culture because it's just so widespread. You know, when Captain Cook left New Zealand for the first time, one of the artifacts he brought back was a surfboard. So their surfing was everywhere. So we know it's at least 1,200 years old, but it's probably much, much older. With the wood, you get a resonance, just like a violin, where you really finely shape the board, and it really takes forever to shape them, to get it just right, because you want just that right roll, like I was showing, the roll in the top and the roll in the bottom, to just get that right flex, and that feeling of being in the wave, and the board will just do magic things for it when you really tune it in. And I'm sure it sounds just like the same as what Richard's doing with the violin. You know, he's got that perfect violin that's perfectly balanced.
Yeah, I wrote down somewhere it was the greatest day of my life, my performing life, because I got this amazing telephone call from an anonymous benefactor claiming that he or she or both wanted to purchase one of the top instruments in the world. And I swallowed hard, gulped, and I brought it to their attention that it had just been released on the market, the Carrotus del Gesù, which amongst violinists, you know, this is earth-shattering stuff. If you even say a Del Gesù, it's a very mystical thing, even more so than Stradivarius, because they're only about 50 in playing condition, and quite a few of those are amongst some of the finest instruments in the world. And so within 2 months, I had this Del Gesù violin under my chin for the rest of my performing career. Being in the incredibly fortunate position, and now having played it for about 6 months, I can say that it's truly one of the great experiences on earth. You know, it's like walking around with the Mona Lisa. In its original setup, the neck was shorter. It would have been strung with raw gut, and it would have made a much softer sound that wouldn't have carried as well as the modern day setup. Now they put in a longer neck and a stronger bridge, and it just is amped up for modern times. I put raw gut on the strings. It creates a softer hue, but a rawer, guttier sound, as you'd imagine. And in a way you could say that is like, you know, taking the fins out and emulating the surf craft of those ancient Hawaiians.
I think what Derek's angle in this whole concept of gathering would be was he said to me a while ago that modern surfing is function without flair. And the same as you can hop on a modern shortboard and turn top to bottom and zigzag and all over the shop, but you don't necessarily have any flow or any flair when you surf that way. Like, if you surf to modern or a single fin, an old school single fin, you have to have really good technique to be able to get that board to perform and sit in the pocket in the right spot. But shortboards are so efficient and they work so excellently well that you can do whatever you want, wherever you want, on the wave. but it doesn't mean that you're actually getting the most out of the wave to do it. So if you knew how to, or if you could ride a single fin and then turn around and ride a modern shortboard, you get more out of it. And that's why some surfers do stand out more than others, because they put their board in the right spot in the right time. So I think his idea with this finless thing was just trying to zero the whole playing field, so to speak, and ride a board that has to work entirely on its rail. And yeah, it's quite an interesting concept. It took me quite a while to get into it, to, you know, it's like such a different way of viewing it, but I think I'm starting to get where he's actually coming from.
Before Jimi Hendrix, there was a guy called Niccolo Paganini, who was a fiddler, and such was his appearance. His limbs were very long. Apparently his fingers were as disgustingly long, and so was his lank hair on his long, ugly head. And he probably smelled a bit too. And he wrote a series of caprices for violin, 24 of them. You probably recognise a piece that we play later on. But this one is fiendishly difficult for one violin, and we've tried to bring back the devil in it by adding another violin. The original tempo is faster than what we take, but and there's this incredible trick bowing that he brings to it, which is... And it's very difficult because you get three bounces and then one up. And its speed is... So here we go. So Satu is going to play the original part, and I'm going to play this counterpoint to it.
Music last night was just phenomenal. The way he moved like was so fast, and it's something like I've never seen anything like it before. I've never been really that big on classical music myself, but when I saw that performance last night, I'm sold on it. You know, it was just phenomenal. And the whole setting and the acoustics in the old cheese factory. Actually, at the end of the performance, there was two old local people, husband and wife, that must have lived in the area. And as they were leaving, they were just shaking their head going, who would ever imagine in the old cheese factory on King Island? And it really sort of touched me how, you know, amazing this event was at that moment, you know.
Found myself like listening to them play, just falling into some trance or something almost, you know. I've never heard music like that live or actually so close, you know. So it was a bit of a shock to the system. It was unreal. I was awestruck, I think, yeah.
He's the best musician I've ever seen, but fingers going all over the place and you make some pretty good noise out of that violin.
Developing here. We may yet call it the Tognetti School because Richard is the guy who's shown the most progress. Just in 1 week, I'd say he's improved 20% as an overall surfer. Feeling free if you want performing jazz on the water.
Once somebody makes a development in something that is accepted by as the norm, it's much harder to keep on evolving. And the likes of, you know, when Simon Anderson made the thruster, you know, and it sort of revolutionized surfing, and everyone got one, and we forgot to consider developing other ways of looking at surfboards. Derek in Australia was the protagonist in inspiring people to look at other surf craft on which you could stand. And the fish, remember the fish was this radical thing, you know, this throwback to the 70s or 60s. And now many people are riding the fish because they find that it's far more suitable than the normal thruster for certain wave conditions. And also you express yourself in a different way. And so it's important, very important, for us to always have our creative intelligence open to new ways of looking at things without just following the pack. And that's what this is about, Musica Surfica, emerging frontiers. And that's why the emerging artist tour with our ACO2, the second orchestra, is very important, because we want to instill in these students, almost there to the profession, this sense of creativity and not just following the pack, not just following ACO, not being just copycats, but coming up with their own ways of expressing themselves.
The project is called Musica Surfica, and we thought we'd collide music and surfing and see what happens. Hallowed space of chamber music just about anywhere in the world. You can't be amplified. You know, amplified music is, you know, a no-go zone. Certainly working with a pop artist in the hallowed hall of Carnegie Hall chamber music series, no way. I'm trying to push for Joseph Tawadros, arguing that it is classical music. It's classical Egyptian music. They don't want to take that. So finding these venues, these country towns, East Coast country town venues, is just perfect, where people are starved of culture. I don't think it's derogatory to say that. So therefore, you know, they're far more open to what we do. And in effect, it's fin-free programming, friction-free programming.
I think
My life was strangely changed yesterday, as was Richard's. We were having a really good four-hour session. We were just about done. 13-year-old kid paddles out. Hey, that looks like fun. Can I have a wave? Not a very good surfer at all. First wave. From here to the end of those trees, as if it's nothing.
It was an amazing flotsam and jetsam of different surf craft and different people in the water. It was fantastic to see so many different unique individuals out there, rather than your kind of competitive surfing attitude of everyone being on a thruster. There was a guy who'd had his leg amputated, and he was out there surfing on a surf ski, and when he had built up enough speed, he stood up and used the paddle as a rudder. And it was one of the most amazing things I've ever seen surfing. It was absolutely fantastic. Then there was a mat rider, Warren the Mat Rider, which is, you know, an amazing art into itself. And then there was this fellow, and he was talking about these ancient Hawaiian surf craft. And his thesis was that they weren't just riding these boards to get from, you know, out the back to the beach, you know, filling in the time, but rather it was an act of self-expression of a very deep and profound nature. And that using these, you know, beautiful wooden boards, they were instruments on which they danced. And that it's a way of expressing in a very unique way one's inner being.